Hello everyone, welcome to the lecture series Simply Structures. My name is Sachin Sanadi and today we are going to discuss the application of wind load on the industrial structures. So for this particular lecture you need to have a copy of IS 875 part 3 and along with that get a copy of pen, notebook and calculator so that you can take a note of each and every parameter. So we'll start with the simple thought, which says that simplicity is the ultimate sophistication by Leonardo da Vinci. So Leonardo da Vinci is one of the famous personality in the history who says that the more simple you make, the more sophisticated it will be. So we'll try to understand this with the simple logic. So we have the requirements for the design of industrial shed. We have already discussed that. So the location is Kolhapur and the parameters are given as 42 meter length, 12 meter span, column height is 10 meter, the roofing material is AC sheet and the percentage of opening because of the doors, windows and ventilators is 15%. So for this particular data, we have to calculate the wind load. So you can see that the shed is of having 12 meter span and it is of 42 meter length. And the height of the column at the eaves level is 10 meter. So we have already discussed about the dead load. We have already discussed about the wind load. You can refer to the channel and you can watch lecture number 1 and 2 for the understanding of dead loads and live load acting on the industrial shed. So in this particular lecture, we'll be looking into the calculation of wind load as per the IS 875 part 3. So the outcome of this lecture that can be expected is understanding what is wind load, the factors affecting the wind load and the calculation procedure given by the IS 875 part 3 2015. So we'll be dealing with the calculation part and understanding part of wind load. So what is wind basically is, it is the movement of air relative to the surface of the earth. That means it is air in motion relative to the surface of the earth. So basically it is in motion. So until and unless you obstruct the air in motion, you cannot be observing that particular air. So wind is nothing but it has to be obstructed so that you can measure it. So wind is measured by obstructing. And for that matter, the first important definition that is required to understand is the basic wind speed. So the basic wind speed is the peak gust velocity averaged over a short interval of time, which is about 3 seconds, and it corresponds to a minimum ground level of 10 meter, and it is observed in the terrain category 2. So that means if the peak gust velocity is averaged over a short interval of time for 3 seconds in the terrain category 2, for the structure having a height up to 10 meter above the mean ground level, that particular wind or that particular gust velocity is considered as the basic wind speed. And this basic wind speed values are already calculated by different methods by the Indian government and the Department of Civil Engineering, and it has been given in the Indian wind map, or you can see that the speed map of India, and you can measure or you can get the basic wind speed value for a particular zone. So you can see that this is a day-to-day experience that you can have, where once the wind is blowing at a very smaller value, you can, the effect of that on the structure is very less, so it cannot be felt. But once the wind velocity is more, then you can see that the structure is deforming with the application of wind load. So the wind load is applied on a particular area and that particular area is responding to that particular wind, and that becomes the wind reaction. So the wind is creating a pressure on a particular surface and that is the wind pressure. So when the structure is able to sustain that particular pressure, it is stable structure, and when the structure is not able to take that particular load, it becomes a unstable or a structure becomes a failure. So we have to design the structure which can take the wind pressure, and the wind pressure will be the wind acting over a particular area. So our job is to calculate the wind pressure on a particular area. So to do that, we need to understand what is wind pressure. So the factors that are going to affect the effect of wind on a particular structure is depending upon the risk level, the terrain and the roughness and the height of the structure, the local topography, the importance factor in the cyclonic region. So what are these factors? We'll be looking into these each and every parameter in detail in the later part of this course. So coming back to the basic wind speed, you can see that this is the basic wind speed map of India, where the entire country is divided into different zones and each zone is having a different value of wind speed. So we can see that the wind speeds are ranging from 33 meter per second to 50 meter per second for different zones. So you can see that it is color coded. So if this particular part, which is having this color, is indicated with 50 meter per second value, and this particular region is having a 33 meter per second value. So it is ranging from 33 meter per second to 50 meter per second, and it is divided into 6 zones. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it is divided into 6 zones. So entire country is divided into 6 zones with different wind speeds. So here you can see that the IS code has given the table giving different wind speeds for different regions of the country in the Appendix A. So each region is given with a different wind speed depending upon the topography of that particular region. So since we are calculating, or since we are constructing the structure in the Kolhapur region, the speed is 39 meter per second because it falls under the Pune region. So we are going to calculate, we are going to have this value of basic wind speed for the calculation, which is 39 meter per second. So try to take a note of this, which we'll be using in the later part for the calculations. So once you get the value of basic wind speed, now you have to convert this basic wind speed into a design wind speed. So what does that mean? What is the difference between basic wind speed and the design wind speed? As we have seen in the earlier part, that the basic wind speed is given for a particular category, that is terrain category 2, and for the structures having a height up to 10 meter. But for the other terrain categories and for other heighted structures, you need to convert this basic wind speed into a design wind speed considering these factors. So what are these factors? We'll be looking into this. So first, K1 is the risk coefficient or the probability factor. Since we are designing with the limit state method, it is based upon the probability and it is a risk coefficient that we are going to use using the clause number 6.3.1. Then the second one is the K2, that is terrain roughness or the height factor, and with the help of clause number 6.3.2, we'll be calculating or we'll be measuring the value K2. Similarly, topography factor with the help of 6.3.3 and K4 value with the help of 6.3.4. So we'll be dealing with K1 initially, and then later on we'll go to K2, K3 and K4. So to calculate the value of K1, that is the probability factor, we'll go to the Indian Standard Code and we'll try to understand the value of K1. So the table number 1 gives us the risk coefficient for different class of structure in different zones, and it depends upon the mean probable life of the structure, and it also depends upon the basic wind speed. So depends for how many years you want that structure to be sustained the wind load. So we are going to consider that the building is of general building and it is general structure, and the design life of the structure is 50 years and our basic wind speed is 39 meter per second. So for the general structure of 50 years lifespan, the basic wind speed is 39 meter per second, so the coefficient will be 1. Similarly, if the structure is of temporary kind of a thing, then you will have a lesser lifetime and then you will have a lesser coefficient. Similarly, if it is of more important structure, you will have a higher life period and higher coefficient for the value of K1. So for our case, we are considering 50 years of lifetime, and for 39 meter per second value, we will be getting the value of K1 as 1. So the value of K1 that we have seen here is 1. Now we'll go to the value of K2, which is the terrain roughness and height factor, which can be seen in the clause number 6.3.2. And for this particular part, you need to understand what is a terrain category. So first we'll understand what is terrain category, and then we'll try to understand the value of K2. So the terrain category that can be defined is given in the IS 875. So the first terrain category is the exposed open terrain with few or no obstructions in which the average height of any object surrounding the structure is less than 1.5 meter. That means if you are designing a particular structure in which where the surrounding structures or the structures around that particular structure that you are considering is less than 1.5 meter and those are few obstructions, then it comes under the category 1. Then if you are going for the terrain category 2, what does that mean is it is having a well scattered obstructions. So it is terrain category 2, which is having a well scattered obstructions having heights generally between 1.5 meter to 10 meter. So well scattered buildings having height up to 10 meter can be considered in the category 2. Then in the category 3, you have terrain with numerously closely spaced obstructions having the size of the building structures up to 10 meter in height with or without isolated tall structures. So in the terrain category 3, you will be having a closed space structures up to a height of 10 meter. So the difference between terrain category 2 and 3 is here the well scattered obstructions are there, but here the obstructions are closely spaced and the height is up to 10 meter. And in addition to that, you have a tall structures, either few isolated tall structures or not. So this is the terrain category 3. In the terrain category 4, you have a terrain with numerously large, high, closely spaced obstructions. So that means it is the crowded area that you can see for the terrain category 4. So we'll understand these categories with the help of pictures. So in this case, you can see the photograph of a terrain category 1, where you can see that there are very few obstructions in this particular region where you are going to construct. So here with the help of photograph, you can see that this is the terrain category 1 where the obstructions are very less. And if you want to construct any particular building in this particular region, the wind will be directly applicable to that particular structure. The wind will directly reach. There are no obstructions on that particular structure. So with the wind will be reaching to that part of construction with its full speed. Then if you go to terrain category 2, then it has got certain obstructions, but again, those are not closely spaced. There are few obstructions here. So the percentage of wind that will be reaching to a particular construction site will be less compared to terrain category 1. See, in this terrain category 3, you can see that there are few obstructions which are having a height up to 10 meter and those are closely spaced. So that the percentage of wind that will be reaching to a point of construction, either you construct here or here, will be obstructed by these particular structures. And then the last one, which is the category 4, which you can see, which is a crowded region with numerously closed spaced structures and there are tall structures as well. So this is the terrain category 4. So for our structure, we'll be assuming the terrain category 3, where there are few obstructions in this particular region and we'll be constructing the industrial shed in this particular kind of terrain category. So considering this particular terrain category, the height factor will be tight. So considering the terrain category 3, and now looking into the height factor, we'll be calculating the value of K2 and we'll be applying that to basic wind speed. So we'll go to the IS code and we'll try to understand the value of K2. So from table number 2, we can see that for a different height and for different terrain categories, there are different coefficients which are given in the IS code. So you can see that the coefficients are getting increased as the height increases, and these are again decreasing as the terrain category increases. That means for the terrain category 1, the wind coefficient is more, and for terrain category 4, the wind coefficient is less. What does that mean is the terrain category is having an open area where the wind speed will be reaching to the particular construction site at its full speed. But in the terrain category 4, it is crowded area, obstructed area, where the wind speed or the wind will not reach to the site at its full speed. So it will be reduced one. So 20% reduction can be expected here, and here there will be more percentage of wind because of the open land and because of the changes in the temperature and atmospheric variations. So it was more coefficient over here and less coefficient over here. So considering this, for our structure, the height is 10 meter and the terrain category is 3, so the value of K2 will be 0.91. Now the next part is coming to the topography factor K3. For this particular part, we need to understand what is the upwind slope. So we'll try to understand what is upwind slope. So you can see that in this particular case, you have an upwind slope. Now the wind is blowing in this particular region, in this particular direction, and it is having a slope when you construct a building over here. So this particular part is considered as the upwind slope theta. If this value of theta is less than 30 degrees, then the value of K1 is considered as, the value of K3 is considered as 1. And if it is more than 3 degrees, we have to calculate considering the different aspects or the upwind slope calculations. So now, since we don't know the upwind slope value, we'll assume that it is less than 3 degrees and we'll try to calculate the value of K3. So you can see that in the clause number 6.3.3, the effect of topography shall be insignificant at a site when the upwind slope is more than 3 degree, and below that the value of K3 can be taken as 1. So we'll be considering the value of K3 as 1 and assuming the upwind slope is less than 3 degree. So the value of topography factor is considered as 1 in this particular case. Now the next important factor is the importance of cyclonic factor in this particular part. So we'll try to understand that. So the importance factor for the cyclonic region, which is given here. So for the structures having a post cyclone importance, such as hospitals, schools and communication towers, the value of K3 is 1.4, value of K4 is 1.3. For industrial structures, the value of K4 is 1.15, and value of K4 for all other structures is 1. So we'll be considering the industrial structure, so we'll be assuming the value of K3 as 1.15. So now, since we know all the values of K1, K2, K3, K4, we can calculate the value of design wind speed. So we'll be doing that by considering the features of the given industrial shed for the design. Now once you get the value of design wind pressure, now we have design wind speed. Now once you get the value of design wind speed, now we'll calculate the design wind pressure. Now to calculate the design wind pressure, first we have to calculate the value of pressure, wind pressure at a particular height. And for that particular part, the Indian Standard Code has given this particular equation using which you can convert the wind speed into a pressure, and that is 0.6 Vz square. So if I substitute the value of Vz which we have calculated in this particular part, can be used and can be calculated as a pressure. So once I calculate the value of Pz, now I'll calculate the value of Pd, considering Kd, Kc and Ka. Now each factor has a different value. So Kd is a wind directionality factor, Kc is a combination factor, and K is an area averaging factor. So now we'll try to calculate the value of Kd, Kc and Ka by considering the Indian Standard Code. So here you can see the value of Pz is given as 0.6 Vz and Pd is given as Kd, Ka and Kc multiplied by Pz. Now Kd is a wind directionality factor which is given here. So wind directionality factor, considering the randomness in the direction of the wind, you're going to apply a wind directionality factor, and that is given in this particular clause, which is 0.9 for the buildings, lattice frameworks, truss towers of triangular square and rectangular sections or rectangular shape, and for the circular shapes it is 1, and for the cyclonic region structures it is considered as 1. So our structure is a building structure with a truss tower, so we'll be considering the value of Kd as 0.9 for the building kind of structures. Now the value of area averaging factor, it depends upon the area of the structural member supporting the cladding. But since we don't know the area of the cladding supported by that particular structural member, so we'll be considering the value of K as 1 itself. If you want to calculate an accurate value of K, then you have to decide which member you are designing. Suppose you are designing a purlin, then the cladding supported by that purlin can be calculated and can be considered in the calculation of area averaging factor. But since 1 is a conservative value, we'll be considering the value of 1 in the calculation of KA. And the next important part is the value of Kc, that is the combination factor. So the combination factor is given in the clause number 7.3.13, which is for the correlation between the combined effect of internal pressure and the suction. So when taking the wind loads on frames of a clad building, it is reasonable to assume that the pressure or the suctions inside and the outside the structure shall not be fully correlated, and for that matter you are considering the value of Kc as 0.9. So once you get the value of Kc, Ka and Kd, you can calculate the value of Pd. So now we have got the value of Kd, Kc and Ka. So now we can find out the value of Pd. Once you get the value of Pd, then you can apply this wind pressure on a particular surface to calculate the force on the structural member. But again, for this particular part, you need to calculate the external pressure coefficient and internal pressure coefficient. So first we understand what is this external pressure coefficient and internal pressure coefficient, and then we'll try to calculate these values. So coming back to the internal pressure coefficient and external pressure coefficient, here you can see that there are two types of buildings. One building is enclosed building and one building is partially enclosed building. So the enclosed building means there is no chance of wind getting inside the building. So entire wind will be applied only on the surface, and the wind is blowing from this particular direction. So it is the windward side and this is the leeward side, and it is having upward pressure acting on the roof. And this pressure is because of the Eddy's effect that we can see here. So here you can see, even if the wind is blowing in this particular direction, it creates a pressure over here and it creates an Eddy's effect, which is a negative pressure and the suction. So the wind is blowing in this particular direction, it is a positive pressure or the pressure on the windward side, and this is the negative pressure, which is the suction pressure, which is acting away from the shed. So whether the force or the pressure which is acting towards the structure is considered as positive, and the pressure which is acting away from the structure is considered as negative, and this is the external pressure that is applied on the structure. So this is windward side, so this is the external pressure on all four sides because of the Eddy's effect and because of the wind speed. Now once the wind is allowed to enter into the building because of certain openings, then it creates the internal pressure. Since the wind is entering into the building, it tries to find ways to go out of the building, and in doing that, it creates pressure on the inside of the structure. So this internal pressure depends upon the percentage of wind or the percentage of openings that are provided in the structure. So more is the percentage, more the wind will enter and more the pressure will it create inside the building. So considering this, we'll be calculating the values of CPE and CPI. So the force on this individual member can be calculated once you calculate the value of CPE and CPI. So first we'll try to understand what is CPE, and then we'll try to calculate the value of CPI. So to calculate the CPE value, again we'll go to the Indian Standard Code. So here you can see there is a table number 6 in which the values of different values of CPE for different roof angles and different height to width ratios are given. So this is depending upon the height to width ratio. That means it is depending upon the stability of the structure. If the height is more and the width is less, then it is going to have a larger pressure, and if the height is less, width is more, it is going to have a lesser pressure coefficient. And also it depends upon the roof angle that we have already calculated while calculating the live load. So the roof angle that we have is alpha, which is 18.43. So now for this particular value of alpha and the value of h by w, we have to calculate the values of CPE for this particular, from this particular table. So we'll be calculating that once you start with the actual problem. Now the value of CPI is given as internal pressure coefficient. Again, this is based upon the percentage of opening that we have already discussed. So the percentage of opening in this structure will affect the value of CPI. So we'll go to the Indian Standard Code and we'll try to understand what are the values. So in this particular IS code, you can see that the internal pressure coefficients are given. If the percentage of openings is not more than 5%, then the pressure coefficients are considered as plus minus 0.2. Then if the percentage of opening is between 5 to 20%, then you can consider the value of, if the percentage of opening is between 5 to 20%, then you can consider the coefficients as plus minus 0.5. and if the percentage of opening is more than 20% or the openings are larger than 20%, then you can consider the percentage of or the coefficients as plus minus 0.7. since the percentage of opening in our case is 15%, which is between 5 to 20, we'll be using the value of CPI as plus minus 0.5. So once you know the value of CPE and CPI, you can apply that in this particular equation and you can calculate the force on a particular structural members. So we'll be applying these procedures in the solving of actual problem. So the basic wind speed for the structure under consideration is 39 m/s. Since it is a Pune region, so the value of VB is 39 m/s. So the value of K1 from the clause number 6.3.1, we can see that it is 1. For K2 it is 0.91. For K3 is 1, and for K4 it is 1.15. So all these values we have already seen. We can understand, or you can refer back to the code and you can get the values of K1, K2, K3 and K4. Once I substitute the values of K1, K2, K3, K4 and the value of VB, I will get the value of VZ, which is 40.81 m/s. So this is the now design wind speed from the basic wind speed. So once I get the design wind speed, I can convert this into a wind pressure. So now I'm converting this into a wind pressure by considering this particular equation, which is given in the IS code itself. So 0.6 VZ square. So now you are converting the wind speed meter per second to Newton per meter square by using this equation. So I know the value of VZ and I can know the value of PZ now. So once I calculate that, it becomes 999.27. Once I know the value of PZ, now I have to calculate the value of PD for the designed wind pressure. So now we have seen that the value of KA, KD and KC are 1, 0.9 and 0.9. So applying these coefficients, we can calculate the value of PD from the value of PZ. So PZ will be 999.27 multiplied by 1 multiplied by 0.9 multiplied by 0.9. It becomes 809.41. So this is the designed wind pressure on a particular structural member, but that has to be multiplied with CPE and CPI. So now to calculate the value of CPE, first we need to understand the height to width ratio and the roof angle, and we are referring to the table number 6 which gives us the values of CPE for pitched roof of rectangular clad building. So now considering the value of height, which is the column height 10 m, width is 12 m. So height to width ratio is 0.83, which is more than half, and the value of alpha, which is 18.43, we have already calculated. The value of CPE can be calculated. So we'll go to the IS code and we'll try to understand the values. So coming back to the IS code, you can see that the values of H by W, which is 0.83, which comes under this particular part. So considering this particular part, which is H by W is more than half, but it is less than 3.5. And the value of alpha is between 10 degree and 20 degree. So we have to interpolate to get the required value. So now you can see that for 10 degree, there are different values given here. And for 20 degree, there are different values given over here. So we can interpolate in between these two values. And by linear interpolation, it will get the value of CPE for 18.43 degree. Now first we have to understand what is this EF, GH, EG and FH. And for this, we have to refer to the figure given in the IS code. So we can refer to this particular part, where this is the length of the shade and this is the width of the shade. And here what they have given is the wind is blowing in this particular direction, making an angle of theta. So now once I consider the value of theta is equals to 0, the wind will be blowing in this particular direction exactly at an angle of 0 degree with respect to the length of the shade. So it will be perpendicular to the shade. And in that case, this will be the windward side and this will be the leeward side. But once the wind changes its direction, that means once the value of theta becomes 90 degree, the wind will be blowing from this particular direction. And in that case, this becomes the windward side and this becomes the leeward side. So we have to consider the windward side for this particular case and leeward side for this case, similarly for the 90 degree case. So considering this, we have these values. So for when the wind angle is 0 degree, EF and GH, you have two values, and when the wind angle is 90 degree, you have EG and FH, two values. So we have to calculate these four values for the value of alpha equals to 18.43. So from the IS code, I have taken the values of CP for 10 degree and 20 degree, and for 18.43 degree, I have interpolated and I have got the values of CP for 18.43 here. So you can calculate, interpolate, and you can calculate the values for 18.43 degree. And in the earlier case, we have seen the internal pressure coefficient, and we know that the percentage of opening for the structure under consideration is 15%, so the value of CPI is plus minus 0.5. So the value of CPI that we are considering here is 0.5 plus minus. So that can be positive and can be negative. So we have to take the values CPI plus 0.5 and minus 0.5, and we have to check the most critical output. So we'll be combining this value of CPI with the CPE and we'll try to identify the value of most critical friction. So once I try to combine this with the value of CPI and CPE, you can see that if I consider the value of CPI as positive 0.5, then what will happen? Then it becomes CPE minus CPI. But if I consider the value of CPI as negative, then it becomes CPE plus CPI. So I have to calculate for CPE plus CPI and CPE minus CPI. So I have the values of CPE here, and I know the value of CPI as plus minus 0.5. So I'm going to combine this value of CPI with the CPE. So minus 0.76 minus 0.5 will be 1.26 negative. So you can see that it is the calculation that I'm showing here. Repeating the similar procedure, you can get the other values also. Then once I change the value of CPI to minus 0.5, it becomes minus minus plus. So minus 0.76 plus 0.5, it becomes minus 0.26, and we'll be getting the remaining values following the similar procedure. Once I get the values of CPE minus CPI and CPE plus CPI, I can plot that in a truss diagram, where you can see that the values of CPE plus minus CPI are given here for the wind angle equals to 0 degree and similarly for wind angle equals to 90 degree. So preferably, you have to design the structure for each of the combinations, but it will be too lengthy. So what we'll do is we'll try to calculate the maximum pressure effect on the truss, and that is 1.3. So out of all these combinations, the maximum coefficient or maximum factor that affects the structure is minus 1.3, which is the maximum one, and we'll be considering that. But for the software purpose, you have to consider all the combinations for the calculation of wind load. So once I consider this value of minus 1.3, I'll be calculating the value of design wind pressure or the pressure on the roof. So once I know the value of CPE plus minus CPI, and once I know the value of PD, I can calculate the pressure on the roof, and that pressure on the roof will be equals to minus 809.41 or 809.41 minus 1.3, so it will be 1052.23 newton per meter square, and this is the pressure. So sorry, because here it is not PD, it is P. So this pressure is acting on the roof now. So now we are dealing with the roof, so this pressure will be acting on the roof, which is minus 1052.23 newton per meter square, or I can say that the pressure is 1.05 kilonewton per meter square, and it is acting away from the truss since it is a negative value. So once I get the value of design pressure or the pressure acting on the roof, then I can multiply that pressure with a particular area supported by the structural element. I can calculate the force on that particular element. I can design the element. So this completes the calculation of wind load on a particular truss. In the next lecture, we'll be calculating the forces acting on the nodal points of the truss, and we'll be analyzing the truss for those loads. So for the next lecture, the homework part is try to revise the method of joints and method of sections so that it will be easier for you to understand the analysis of truss under consideration for the design for the dead load, wind load, and the live load. Thank you.